Up in the morning and out to school. The teacher is teaching the golden rule.
Good morning to the East Ramapo Underground. This is your co-host, Antonio Luciano, with
Peggy Hatton. Welcome.
Well, we're going to have a really exciting show, so we're going to get right into it. Today, we're going to have a gift certificate of your choice for breakfast and lunch for two at Ralphie's Diner. Ralphie's Diner is located at 8 Remsen Avenue, Muncie, at the corner of Route 59 and Remsen. Support a local business and stop into Ralphie's Diner anytime you're in the area for good food and free advice. Ralphie's Diner is the place to get both at the same time. If you don't win the contest, stop into Ralphie's Diner anyway, where free advice is always given. And now we'll go to our heroes and zeros of the week.
Okay, we're going to have a hero and zero of the week segment with brand new set of heroes and zeros. This week, the hero of the week is the auditor for the East Ramapo School District, Denise Connell, CPA. The reason that Denise is getting the hero of the week is because she exposed the overpayment of legal costs for the district. I'd like to read to you what she discovered. There was a duplicate toll charge on the legal bill from Minerva and D'Agostino due to two lawyers both traveling to the district together. The district personnel asked for toll receipts, but the law firm has refused to provide them. The claims auditor recommends that legal contract be reviewed and revised. The auditor has analyzed legal costs as compared to several other districts and found that this district to be paying the highest rate for legal services as well as paying for extra travel time. That's what we've been saying, and even the students of the district have been saying for a long time. What's the need for two lawyers at meetings? The corrective action plan that she proposed was to remove the duplicate charges from the invoice. So for that reason, we are giving our claims auditor, Denise Connell, the hero of the week. Just as a little side note, that particular audit firm is no longer going to be performing the services of auditor, claims auditor for the district. They're putting that out to bid. I guess they don't like what Denise had to say. And so if you say something that the district or the Board of Education doesn't like, you're likely to get chopped. So there we go. That's the hero of the week. For the zero of the week, I am saying that Minerva and D'Agostino, our law firm, is the zero of the week for refusing to comply with submitting the toll receipts that the district had asked for. What could be the reason that they wouldn't be able to just submit their EasyPass documentation to show what their tolls are? And really, I have a problem with paying tolls also, and also the $250 an hour for transportation costs. So for that reason, Minerva and D'Agostino, you are the zero of the week.
Now, Peggy, I get Easy Pass, and I wonder, like, why would the law firm not turn over their records? What are they hiding? When somebody refuses to divulge information, you have to ask yourself that question. What are they hiding?
You know, I'm not even a police lieutenant the way you were, Tony, but it makes me wonder as well. It should be very easy to come up with those statements, and if the claims auditor is asking for it, you would think that the legal people for our school district would be happy to comply. So really, really a real reason for us to be concerned.
Absolutely, Peggy. But tonight I want to let everybody know, all our listeners, that they can meet the candidates. There's going to be a forum for the East Ramapo School Board candidates tonight at 7 o'clock at the Lewis Kurtz Civic Center at 9 North Main Street in Spring Valley. So you can come out and meet Kim Foscue, Hiram Rivera, and Joanne Thompson.
And we hope that the opposing candidates will also come out so that there will be a real debate instead of just talking amongst ourselves.
Well, usually they don't show up at all. That's the disdain for the public that they have.
Right.
But it was an interesting meeting last night, and you know, they had the budget discussion first, and there was one child that was really touching, and they talked about choices, and they made reference to a cartoon that you're given a difficult choice, and the choice in this cartoon appears an angel on one shoulder that tells you the right thing to do, and then on the other shoulder pops up the devil, and the devil gives his point of view, and that the choices are between the two, the good and the evil. And the child said, you know what, it appears that the East Ramapo School Board just listens to the devil on their shoulder.
Yep, that's what they said. The board members looked a little shocked, but I think that was basically that there's a cultural divide, and you know, they don't know, they haven't seen the Disney cartoons that she's referencing to, because that goes on all the time. I don't think they're listening to the devil, but I do wonder who they are listening to. You know, one of the things that happened last night, in addition, was Dr. Klein could not answer many of the questions that were asked about the budget once again. It seems the mantra is, I don't know. How many classes are being cut this year?
Wait, Peggy, did you mention Dr. Klein?
Yes, I did. That's the magic word, Dr. Klein.
Well, he needs his own special introduction.
He does. Sorry, I should have cued you on that one. But, you know, Dr. Klein was not giving answers about exactly what 25% of the offerings after school for extracurriculars were going to be cut. Will it be swimming? Will it be tennis? Will it be fencing? Will it be fencing? Oh, we don't have fencing, right? maybe it could be lacrosse. Oh, wait a minute, we don't have lacrosse either. What other wonderful clubs is he going to cut from our children? You know, when you go to other school districts and they do have all of these wonderful extracurricular activities, those kids would be also asking, what are you going to cut? No answers. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. That's the mantra over and over again. We also don't know, even though this is the 3rd of May, what electives, let's talk about education, what electives are going to be cut? Finally, when pressed by one of the board members last night, he admitted that there will be 145 less sections or course offerings for our students next year. And so that means that our students will be sitting in more study halls, and he doesn't seem to really mind that. So if a child doesn't do well in two courses, and to be honest with you, here we are in May, and we've been asking since September how the kids are doing, and we never get an answer to that. How many kids are failing one or more courses in East Ramapo? We don't get an answer to those questions. But if a child is failing one or more classes, guess what? They're not going to graduate in 4 years. They're going to graduate in 5 years. Or maybe they'll graduate in 6 years. Or maybe if they're an ESL student, they'll graduate, or they'll age out of the system completely at the age of 21. What a wonderful legacy Dr. Klein's leaving for our students.
And I'd just like to let all the listeners know, our studio lines are open at 362-0013. We will be taking calls. So call in whenever you feel like calling. But Peg, at the meeting last night, what was really telling from the religious school board members was all the giggling that was going on, like little girls.
Well, it's not just the giggling that was very disconcerting, Tony, but as we know, and as you have on videotape, which we can post on East Ramapo Underground Facebook later, some of our board members really spend most of their time, instead of listening to what the students are saying and begging for to keep their programming, they're using their BlackBerries under the table. Or some of them are as bold as to just put put up their tablets, their iPads, and just be looking at the iPads. And so a lot of people in the audience were talking about the fact that they don't look up and give eye contact to the kids or give their attention or other speakers when they speak. We've brought this up time and time again. One girl last night, one of our students, I was so proud of her, had the chutzpah to actually stop and wait for her to get the attention of a school board member because they were busy on their BlackBerry. What other school district, and I say this again, where else but East Ramapo would that kind of behavior by a school board member be allowed? What gives them the right to disrespect our students?
And Peggy, a lot of questions go unanswered. And one of the questions last night was about safety in the schools with the cuts of assistant principals and security personnel. There's a problem in East Ramapo that's usually not talked about, and that's improper or unauthorized people on school grounds while school is in session. And nothing actually happens to these people.
I can speak to this firsthand because my child went, both of my boys went to Elmwood Elementary School in the Muncie area. And quite often while the kids were out there at recess or at lunchtime, after lunch, people would just walk through the school grounds going from their homes to wherever they were going. And the teachers would stop them and say, I'm sorry, but you can't come through here. What will it take? Will it take for a child to be kidnapped or abused, or what will it take for the district to put up? All they're asking for is no trespassing signs. The NAACP, the Padres United, and the PTA, as a group, have come together to ask this school board and this administration in East Ramapo to please put up no trespassing signs. And the reason why that's key, you think it's a small thing, but the reason it's key is that when they call the police say that there are no trespassing signs, and so they can do nothing to remove people from the school grounds, sharing the space with our students. Do you think that that would go over in Clarkstown or Nanuet or Nyack or Pearl River? You think people, just anyone, could just walk through the school playground while the kids are out there? I don't think so. And that is another reason why East Ramapo is different. And it's dangerous. Actually, one of the people at the meeting last night said that they did a search of pedophiles in the area of just that particular school of Elmwood Elementary. And that, I think, Tony, was it within a mile of this school, there were 20 registered sex offenders?
Oh, yes.
And so, you know, we're not saying that the people that are walking through there are sex offenders, but they could be. We don't know who these people are. And, you know, quite often when the teachers would stop them, they would say, their answer was, the board says we can do this. Well, I'm a parent, and I'm here to tell you that I don't find that acceptable.
Well, any parent that sends their children to school expect them to be learn in a safe environment. And that's crucial to a public school system and any public school, even the non-publics. They expect their property to be held sovereign while school is in session.
I don't think parents realize that this is actually happening.
No, I think it's the dirty little secret that East Ramapo doesn't want to let out. We do have a call. Good morning, you're on East Ramapo Underground on WRCR 1300.
Good morning, how are you?
Good, thanks.
Good, thanks.
Okay, my name is Al. I called a couple of weeks back about trying to figure out a way that we could get consolidation of the school districts, like maybe on the ballot or something. You had said you were going to do some research into it. I was wondering if you had any chance to do anything with that.
Well, each school district would actually have to vote to dissolve itself and combine with another school district. So it doesn't look like other school districts in Rockland County would want to absorb with East Ramapo.
Well, I have a different take on it, to be honest with you. The East Ramapo Central School District actually could dissolve itself. The board would have to do that. Then it is unclear. They do have the power to do that. And maybe if we get a new board in place, that will happen. I don't know if you listened last week, but I did. We did talk about that in our fractured fairy tale of East Ramapo. That wouldn't it be nice if we could dissolve East Ramapo and send our children to other districts. It would save us money, our taxes would go down, and we believe that our children would get a better education because the school boards in other districts, I think, have the students' best interests at heart, and they're not interested in just cutting everything that has to do directly with the kids. But, of course, our board has no problem with increasing the budget from just a couple of years ago for legal expenses from $335,000 to over $600,000 for next year. So do we think it's a good idea? You bet I can talk for myself. You bet I do. And I think that if we were able to gain control of the board, we could certainly move in that direction.
Yes, but it would take cooperation from all the other school districts.
Well, I'm not sure.
Each individual district would have to dissolve, you're saying.
Just East Ramapo would have to dissolve.
Well, East Ramapo could dissolve, but...
then what would happen to everybody in the district?
Then the state would have to step in and decide exactly how those children would be parceled out. But, you know, Governor Cuomo is one of the first people to say that he believes in consolidation. I think that there probably would be other school districts who would not necessarily want our children, but I think that if we could count on the governor, since it is his baby, for consolidation, to press that and make that happen. I think that would be the best way to take care of all of the problems of East Ramapo in one fell swoop.
Right, yeah, well, then I'm going to try to contact the governor's office and see if anybody there will listen to me.
Absolutely.
I have the governor's phone number for his office.
Okay, go ahead.
It's 518-474-8390.
8390.
Yeah,
okay, great. I'm going to give him a call.
And you can actually write him a letter at... Governor Cuomo, the New York State Capitol Building, Albany, New York, 12224 is the zip code. Or you can go on the governor's website for New York State and email him. But I would definitely give him a call because consolidation of especially within Rockland County, should be financially feasible to do. We're paying for so many duplicate services in all these school districts, were paying for all these high-priced superintendents, and it has to stop somewhere.
Right. No, I definitely agree. All right. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Thank you,
Alan, for calling.
Another issue that we can talk about that was, again, brought up, it gets brought up quite often, but we don't really have a solution, is when you ask Dr. Klein about the Medicaid reimbursement. I'd like to explain what exactly that is and why are school districts in the business of Medicaid reimbursement? You can charge for services for children who have disabilities. We have $4 million that was supposed to be budgeted for this, and we've so far only gotten $387,000. That's quite a huge shortfall. I think we have another call, Tony.
Good morning. You're on East Ramapo Underground at WRCR 1300.
Good morning. I'm a graduate of Ramapo High School.
And what's your name?
My name is Bonnie.
Hi, Bonnie.
And I graduated in the class of 59 from the high school on 59.
Wow.
And it was great. And my question to you is, when you're talking about consolidation, what about East Ramapo and Ramapo Central? They're both, you know, Ramapos. You never talk about them.
Well, actually, I had written a letter to the editor probably 4 or 5 years ago now, and my letter was titled The Tale of Two Cities. And the reason for that is because here we have two segregated school districts. Let's talk about that for a moment. Within the same town, the same border. At that time, there was 90% children of color in East Ramapo, and just the opposite, 90% white children in in Ramapo Central. And so there is no reason why those two school districts should not be combined. But we can go even further and just disband the district altogether and go out into all of the surrounding districts.
Well, I don't agree with, because I live in a, you know, in a whole other area, you know, closer to, you know, Nyack, Orangetown. But there's no reason why there wouldn't be. You have the same supervisor. Mm-hmm. You have your Ramapo. There's no reason why you can't combine the two.
Well, we agree. But, you know, I happen to live in the last street in New York State, and my kids would actually be closer to Pearl River than they would be to any place else. But do we have another call, Tony?
No, but we'll take Bonnie. You know,
okay, Bonnie.
We'll ask some Bonnie's question.
Yeah, you know, no, I'm just saying when you're talking about consolidation, that's the obvious consolidation.
Mm-hmm.
They're right next to each other, and they should be, if any consolidation, the two Ramapo school districts should be consolidated together. And then you would have a good mix.
Absolutely, but all of Rockland County is hurting, and one of the easiest ways to consolidate is the school districts.
You know, East Ramapo is such an interesting place because it goes from the border of New Jersey, because my backyard is literally in Montvale, all the way up to Pomona and into the town of Havistraw. It's huge.
I know.
And there are so many school districts that border us that it could be as simple as just saying all of the town of Ramapo be one school district. Or it could also, if that's overwhelming for one particular school district, it could be spread out. I'm agreeable to looking at all of those models. I think that it's important for the taxpayers, but more importantly, it's important for our children to get a quality education. Our kids do not get the same access to AP courses and to curricular activities and sports and music that the other students get.
Well,
I mean, I was kidding before about lacrosse and fencing, but you know, actually, my child took fencing. I paid for it on my own, and there are so many fencing scholarships out there. Not one child from East Ramapo is ever going to get a scholarship for fencing. Why do we get less?
Same thing. You could say the same thing about, you know, schools that have swimming pools.
Well,
I mean, most districts don't have swimming pools. There are a couple that do.
That's right.
You know, but I still think, having grown up and gone to, you know, East Ramapo, which I think I had a very fine education, I think that the two Ramapos should be together. That's my opinion. I don't think that you should start going, you know, where out of your Ramapo district is what I'm talking about, because my niece and nephew graduated from, they lived in Suffern, so they graduated from the other, you know, schools.
Right. Yeah.
And that's my opinion. Anyway.
Okay, thank you, Bonnie.
Thank you very much.
And we have another call. Good morning to East Ramapo Underground on WRCR 1300.
Good morning.
Good morning.
When you talk about wanting to merge school districts together, I have a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
Your equalization rate that you pay towards school taxes is about one-third of what we'd pay in Orangetown. What's your opinion on that?
Well, I think that taxes is, I'm not a tax expert by any stretch of the imagination. I can tell you that we're also one of the only school districts that doesn't have a separate rate for residences versus businesses in Ramapo. And so that's also another interesting concept. I think that the tax equalization rate would have to be addressed, obviously, if we were going to dissolve East Ramapo.
Do you think you could afford the taxes of paying two-thirds more than you're paying now?
Well, maybe your taxes would be reduced because you would be getting a lot more from East Ramapo in terms of state aid than you are getting right now in your particular school district.
A lot of maybes. Too bad.
but it's something that has to be explored. You just can't.
Yes, it has to be explored, but it's a concept that you have to realize when you're sitting there saying you're paying a 13.86% equalization rate. That's about one-third of what we pay here in Orangetown. So it's something you guys have to think of as far as, you know, of course you get more services when you pay a lot more money.
Right, but you know what? Here's my question to you. Just because our children are unlucky enough to live in East Ramapo, and they are unlucky, does that mean they should be entitled to less of an education than their counterparts from your school district?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
It's a crying shame what's happening here. I'm not saying that. I'm totally agreeing with you.
Mm-hmm.
You're doing everything right, and I can't believe you have the nerve to put your life on the line like this. So I commend you for this. You have more strength than I can have.
Well, that's why I have my bodyguard, 6'4", Lieutenant Luciano, with me all the time.
Well, maybe you could take what you have to pay him for being your bodyguard and put it good towards school tax.
Actually, he's free, and he's yeah. my bud. So.
And I work for peanuts, let me tell you.
But yes,
my paycheck is zero every week.
Everything has to be explored. Every option.
You know, we believe that it's a civil right for our kids to get an education. And, you know, I just think that they should all be given the same shot. How can East Ramapo students, how can they compete against the students in your school district when going to college? How can they? And, you know, Dr. Klein last night was talking about a handful of kids that are going to Ivy League schools and how proud he is of them. And I wanted to say, that's all fine, well, and good, Dr. Klein. I'm so proud of those kids, too. Because you know what? They had to work much harder than their counterparts to get there. But what is never addressed is that there are students who go to RCC College and from East Ramapo, and when they get there, they have to take entrance exams to see where they can be placed. I can tell you that every single one of my son's friends that graduated last year, they all had to take remedial math and English to go to Rockland Community College. And half of those kids are on educational probation because they failed those classes. And so we can talk about all the wonderful things. Tony's kid's going to a great school, and he's worked really hard to get there. But what about the kids, the kids that are invisible, that are not doing well? Those are the kids, I have to tell you, that I'm concerned about. Those are the kids who have been the latchkey children, whose parents have to work two and three jobs just to get by. Those are the kids that really break my heart, and we don't address them at all in East Ramapo. But we really thank you for calling in and listening and contributing to our show.
Thank you, and once again, I want to commend you guys
for
the job you're doing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good morning, you're on East Ramapo. Oh, we don't have another call? Okay. But Peggy, the other hidden fact that East Ramapo doesn't talk about is that we have a large and growing Hispanic population. And if you're a Hispanic student in East Ramapo, you're looking at a graduation rate of only 50%, which is a disgrace.
And, you know, to tie into that, not everyone is going to be college bound. Not everyone wants to go to college. Not everyone can afford to go to college. And one of the greatest disservices that East Ramapo has put forth is to cut the career and technology programs at BOCES. For the kids that are not on the college track, why can't they become plumbers or HVAC or mechanics or electricians and gain a trade? That door has been slammed shut in the faces of the children who attend East Ramapo. The kids that need it the most are the ones who won't be able to take advantage of those programs. Why? Because they've cut the budget for BOCES. Last night, someone asked for actually not just someone, our board member, I believe it was Suzanne Young Mercer, and I believe also Joanne Thompson, talked about they want to know exactly what the big cuts are in BOCES. Do you know that neither Dr. Klein nor Michael Ivanoff, the head of the finance department, could answer that question? They hummin' all the way through it, ba 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 ba, and they did not give an answer. What is the answer? What exactly has been cut from BOCES? They have cut Docutech, which is our Docutech actually is a printing area for BOCES. But what about all of the programs that's been cut? That's another big concern. And talking about BOCES and getting back to my big gripe before with the $4 million that Dr. Klein put into the budget for Medicaid reimbursement, he also threw BOCES under the bus last night and said that 57% of the bills that BOCES submits to Medicaid are being rejected. And that's also a big issue. I wonder if he bothered to ask BOCES whether they were willing or able to submit Medicaid bills.
Well, Peggy, before I forget, and it looks like I almost forgot about this, we have our giveaway for Ralphie Ziner at 362-0013. We'll take caller number two for your free breakfast or lunch at Ralphie's Diner. So call us right away, 362-0013.
Okay.
Oh, we have caller number one.
Hello.
Hi, you're caller number one. Good morning. You're caller number two.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Tony.
Hey.
You're the winner.
Yeah?
Rob, you're the winner.
I'm the winner. Thank you both very much.
Yes, and I'll have your gift certificate over at Ralphie's Diner. I'll drop it off later.
Okay.
Okay, Bob. Thanks
thank
a lot.
Thank you both very much.
Thank
Kay.
You.
Goodbye.
Bye. Another issue that was talked about last night is the deteriorating conditions of our school buildings. I can tell you that there are every time it rains, it really rains in East Ramapo. Two of the worst buildings, I think, is in terms of roofs leaking, are Chestnut Ridge Middle School, where my son happens to attend, and also Spring Valley High School. Those poor kids have to run an obstacle course of buckets and garbage cans to get through the hallways from one class to the other when it rains, because guess what? Roofs are guaranteed for 30 years, and our roofs are on year 30. So no big surprise that we have leaks sprouting up all over the place. Tony, was there a plan to fix any of these roofs that are leaking all over the place?
Actually, it doesn't look like there was any plan, but remember there was a building report that came out that said we needed $30 million in repairs over 5 years, and nothing's been done.
That's true. Nothing has been done. I think that the two schools that were excluded from the list were also the two schools that were renting out. That's Colton Elementary School and Hillcrest. So the two schools that were in the best condition are being rented out, and our East Ramapo students are being deprived of using those schools.
And I just want to remind everybody to come out tonight to meet the candidates at the East Ramapo School Board Forum held by the NAACP at 7 o'clock at the Lewis Kurtz Civic Center at 9 North Main Street in Spring Valley.
And, you know, touching on that also, we would like people to come out to meet the candidates. But more important than meeting the candidates is voting for the candidates. All of the ills that we've discussed today and in our previous shows can be changed with a single vote. Every vote counts. Some votes count twice. No, I'm only kidding. Well maybe I'm not kidding.
They actually do, Peggy.
But we need everyone to come out. We do have the numbers to win this election, but we are counting on you, and our kids are counting on you to come out and vote on May 15th from 7 to 10.
Do we have another call? Good morning, you're on East Ramapo Underground at WRCR 1300.
Hi, good morning. I don't know if you talk... My name is Merle. I don't know if you talk about the buses, but I had an experience this morning. I didn't go on the radio with Stephen, but I would like to talk about it, if you don't mind.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, I take my grandson out to the bus 7 o'clock in the mornings. He goes to St. Paul's. This morning, you know, we see cars passing even after the red light is on. But this morning I was surprised. Two buses. There's a little van in front of them. He passed, but before he passed, he slowed down, kind of stopping, then he moved on. But then two school buses passed by with the red light on. I couldn't believe it. You know,
buses passing
red light school bus.
Wow, that's so extremely dangerous.
And illegal.
Especially for a school bus. That's unheard of.
Did you happen to get the names of the school bus?
No, I'm sorry.
Companies?
It happened so fast. All I was thinking about is protecting my grandson from crossing the street.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
You know?
It's important to either get the name of the school bus. It's on the side. It should be on the side.
Yeah.
Or the number of the bus, because that really should be reported. That's totally unacceptable.
I do hope that the other person who was picking up my grandson would do something about it, because it's, to me, that's dangerous. You know, if a person is out there with that grandchild or that child could run across the street. Believe you me, when that bus, the last bus eventually passed, stopped, my grandson walked behind him to go and go on his bus.
Wow.
You know, that's very, very dangerous and careless.
Well,
you know what, I would call over to the school district and complain to the transportation department, because they have a pretty good handle on what buses are around that area at what time. What's the gentleman's name?
Brian Malloy.
Brian Malloy. So call over to the school district and tell them the time that you were there and explain, you know, what happened.
The situation, yeah.
Yeah.
You have the number for that, please?
I don't have it readily available.
The district clerk, know her phone number by memory. So it's 577 6015.
Okay.
And ask to speak to Brian Malloy in transportation. They'll transfer your call.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Right.
And it's been a really good show.
Thanks, everybody, for calling in and participating. And don't forget to vote Foscue, Thompson, and Rivera on May 15th.
Up in the morning and out to school, the teacher is teaching the golden rule, American history and practical math. You study them hard and hoping to pass.